Welcome, welcome. On tonight's menu, we have Polish food. We're gonna need this whole container of sauerkraut. I might need your help opening it. Okay, there we go. To wash or not wash the sauerkraut, that is the question. Side note, if you're new here and this is one of your first around-the-world dinners with us, I'm going to give you a little information, just to clarify things. This series is a challenge for me to try out different recipes and different foods from around the world, to expand my food knowledge and just eat lots of different things. Now, while I try to accurately create each recipe, just know that my way is probably not authentic, and I never claimed it was. I'm just having some fun, and I appreciate all of your guys' suggestions, so I can dine and eat spectacular food from all around the world while I'm stuck at home. It's like going on vacation every day. And yes, my goal is to eventually go to every country to try out an authentic version of every dish I've cooked thus far. But until then, I'ma just make more recipes. So cheers, and I hope you continue dining with me. This episode almost isn't fair to every other country. I make Korean food a lot, like a lot, a lot. But it didn't always used to be this way. I was introduced to South Korean food and culture by my boyfriend, and now I make it all the time because it reminds me of him. But this series has pushed me to explore other countries' cuisines, and I hope to make them just as much. With every new Around the World episode, I learn something new, whether that be about a country or about the dish that I make. I like to read the history or the little backstories behind each food, because then I feel like I'm in the know. Like, spill the tea, what's so dramatic about rice? Well, let me tell you, I did not previously know this, but there is a feud over which country's jollof rice is better. Maybe this is common knowledge, but it wasn't for me. Of course, every family's gonna make it a little bit differently. One of the huge divides, if I'm not mistaken, is between which type of rice is to be used. Today I'm using basmati, and it was pretty damn good. But I've never had it with long grain rice, so I can't personally tell you whose is the best. Please provide me with more drama below. It's Around the World in Food with my most requested country, and also my most requested dish. Honestly, its appearance is deceiving. This recipe is so convoluted. There are at least 8 components, and all of them take at least half an hour each. I thought I was gonna eat this for lunch, but it ended up being linner. And I also think it took a little extra time because I've never made this before, which is the running theme of this series. And therefore I was back and forth reading the instructions because I didn't know what I had to do next. So if this video looks a little messy, then it's got the right spirit. Actually, I forgot about the pasta, so probably 9 components. And after all of that work, it was so satisfying to finally plate it. I was starving, and it seriously hit the spot. I'm ridiculously full now. Bread. What more can I say? Nothing beats a soft, fresh loaf of bread. But bread making can be a little daunting sometimes. That's why Irish soda bread is a great loaf to try your hand at. It involves no yeast, which means you don't have to knead it. Actually, the less you handle it, the better it will be. It's known uniquely for its dense texture, hard crust, and slight sourness. It's traditionally marked with a cross on the top, which came about for superstitious reasons. And I'm not sure if it will ward off evil, especially if the evil is considered to be hungry family members. The best pork belly dish. Oh man. Now you guessed it. We start with pork belly, intimately handled, and then thrown into a boiling pot of water, but only for a minute. Now, if you don't have a cheesecloth, you can use one of those fancy metal loose tea leaf holders. It works quite well. I honestly only remembered that method after I tied up the cheesecloth. My bad. You could put whole spices in, you know, if you're big on biting into a whole clove while you're eating. Whatever floats your boat. As long as you remember to put them in, because I did not show a clip of me doing that. Don't forget your bok choy and your egg. To be honest, I had 2 eggs, but for the purpose of plating, I only showed 1. I'm such a liar. But what's not a lie is the fact that this is. On the chopping block today, we have Jordan. This lamb's name was Jordan. No, I'm kidding. Today, I had to butcher lamb for the first time. Feel free to come for me in the comments. I honestly don't know how bad I did. And if I wasn't already stressed enough from butchering the lamb, these tongs flew open and splashed me with boiling hot water, and I like burnt my whole chest. So if I'm gonna recommend cooking methods, it's not gonna be doing that. Carefully remove your lamb shanks from the water. And we're gonna make a goat yogurt sauce. Honestly, goat yogurt doesn't taste much different from normal yogurt. But I didn't have Jameed, so this was close enough. This is my first time having lamb shank, and I'm not sure if I wanna eat it any other way now. This dish was so good, minus my fatality. We're putting it down on the grill today with Romania. Someone had suggested I make misi, which is a Romanian sausage with a trinity of meats, garlic, and many spices. It's probably my favorite so far because essentially you just throw it all together, pop it in the fridge and let it rest overnight, roll it into these cute little logs, and then pretend you know how to barbecue. And then you'll have a mountain of misi. Time to make the best chicken dish you'll probably ever make, mic drop. A bold statement, I know, but I've eaten many a chicken. I really don't want to know how much, but this takes the cake. You really can't beat dark meat. Don't even try to replace it,
especially not for this recipe because it's not going to work.
The cooking process involves searing the meat, bringing your delicious soy marinade to a simmer, adding the chicken back to the pan, and letting it cook for 20 minutes, covered. Then turning it over, cooking another 20 minutes, and if you can wait any longer, the sauce thickens. Look at the color of this chicken. You can't tell me you don't want to grab that out of the screen right now. Make sure you douse that chicken in that delicious marinade. Oh, adobo, you have my heart. Did you miss me? I know you did. Today's recipe involves potatoes, which means it's going to be good. Surprisingly, I couldn't find a recipe for this Lithuanian dish in English. So, Google Translate, you better not let me down. The only problem I encountered was the fact that the recipe didn't weigh the potatoes. They were just like, use 8. And I was like, how big are your potatoes? I have no idea. So I decided to use 2, which is a pretty big difference. But I did end up reducing the other quantities of the ingredients just because I thought that would make sense. And you know what? Lo and behold, I think it worked. These were so delicious. One of the top 10 potato dishes. Yeah, I know, that's a strong statement. But if you don't believe me, try them for yourself. Oh God, I could have like 5 more. You're gonna wanna get in the kitchen immediately and make this cake. Because this ain't no ordinary chocolate cake. This is a Swedish sticky chocolate cake called kladdkaka. If I said that really badly, I'm sorry, but it's a running theme. I normally don't explain the background of the dishes that I make, but here's a little history for you. This cake originated in World War II when baking powder was not easy to come by. And the name of it derives from a Swedish word meaning sticky or messy, which explains its delectable, gooey interior that is a must-have. Around the world in food, and today we're hitting South Africa. First dessert in the series as well. I'd like to think that dessert is my forte, as I have been trained in it, but I was not always good. Making this recipe reminded me of a time that I seriously fucked up in the kitchen. I was 16 years old working my co-op job, and the head pastry chef left me in charge for the day. I was given a task to make pastry cream. Seems simple, right? I worked at a private club, so I was used to making large batches of food. She had left me a handwritten note with the recipe on it for the pastry cream. Her handwriting wasn't the best, but I should have clued in sooner that she in fact did not write 21 pounds of sugar, and she wrote 2 pounds. Needless to say, it did not work. You know what time it is. It's Around the World in Food, and today we are tackling turkey. We'll be making a Turkish flatbread called pide. Some also like to refer to it as a Turkish pizza of sorts, and I would say that's pretty spot on. Just like you would a pizza, you're gonna start by making the dough. I swear the only time I bring out my mixer is for doughs. Kneading by hand is so last year, but making bread and doughs does give me a lot of satisfaction. Making things from scratch is always impressive, and bread is always so easy. You literally do nothing, you just wait for it to rise. But while you're waiting, you're gonna make the filling for your pide. I did 2 different fillings, 1 beef and 1 chicken, because this recipe makes 2 flatbreads. In both, I put mozzarella, but you can really put anything. Evenly distribute your filling, leaving a little space at the edges so you can fold over your side. If you don't have a pizza stone like I do, you can bake yours at 425 for 15 minutes. And if you want to put a couple eggs, make sure you give them a little extra time to allow them to cook. Go ham with the toppings. I chose cilantro and a homemade spicy yogurt sauce. I sliced them up, and then my family and I annihilated them.